Welcome, and thank you for your interest in learning more about the fundamentals of DHCP. Upon completing this module, you should be able to describe the role of the DHCP protocol, describe the principles of the DHCP service, and last, describe the message flow between the DHCP server and its clients. Let's start by an introduction to the DHCP protocol. Over time, the network device configuration has evolved. In the 1970s, administrators configured network parameters manually on each device. By the 1980s, BOOP was introduced. This protocol automated the device configuration, but it was limited because the settings could not be changed once it was in an operation. In the 1990s, DHCP was designed based on the BOOP protocol to address the online device settings, modifications, and the mobility across networks. The main purpose of the Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol, or DHCP, is to automate the process of configuring devices on a TCP/IP network in order to allow them to use network services such as DNS, NTP, the web, etc. The components of DHCP are simple. As a DHCP server that hands out the configuration data, or also known as the network parameters, according to the network policy set by the administrator. And then we also have the client, or a TCP device, who is the user of the DHCP services. In this configuration, we have a DHCP client in the regional office network, and the DHCP server is located in the headquarters network. The DHCP server is configured with a scope called Toulouse, and it matches the network that the DHCP client is connected to. So how are the network parameters passed? First, the client in the regional office sends a request for an IP address. Second, the DHCP server in the headquarters network responds back with the answer. That includes the IP address, the network mask, and options such as the default gateway, the DNS domain name, and the DNS servers. These are all configurable in the scope that match the client's network. At the completion of this operation, the client now has obtained all of the information that it needs to operate in the regional office network called Toulouse. Also note that the DHCP server does not necessarily need to be local to the client's network. In this example, the DHCP server is located in the headquarters network. We will detail this in a later slide. What are the key network parameters? Some of the common parameters, also known as DHCP options, these are requested by the clients and are configured by the administrators on the DHCP servers. The table below provides a look at each of these options, the code, name, and definition. In the table, we recognize that the options 3, 6, and 15 are some of the most common parameters that are used on the network, and they enable the clients to communicate on the network with each other. What are the benefits of DHCP? The added value of DHCP server is to reduce the operation tasks, where a network administrator no longer has to manually configure each client before it is used on the network initially. Also, to handle mobile clients, when a laptop is moved from a building to another building on a campus, the configuration change would be automatic. And last, to optimize the IP addressing plan, addresses which are no longer being used are free to be reassigned to new clients connecting to the network. What are the key features of the DHCP protocol? The DHCP protocol is based on a client-server architecture. DHCP uses UDP, or User Datagram Protocol, as its transport protocol. The UDP port 68 is used by the DHCP client, and UDP port 67 is the destination port of the DHCP server. Clients are not configured with a DHCP server IP address initially. The clients will send the first message to the server or servers in a broadcast packet. The DHCP protocol is suitable for two kinds of architectures. The first, serving the clients of a shared L2 network, where the DHCP server and the clients are on the same layer 2 network, meaning they're on the same local network, same VLAN. Therefore, the broadcast messages are directly transmitted to the host. The second is the clients that are on a different L2 network, where the DHCP server and the clients are on different layer 2 networks. In this case, there is an IP router that separates the networks. This IP router will stop the broadcast messages. However, there is a method used on the servers or routers of the different L2 networks, which is called a relay agent function. That will convert the broadcast message to a unicast message and send it to the specific DHCP server that's configured. For example, this would be an IP helper configuration on a Cisco router. And that is how the client in that last chapter was able to attain its IP address when the DHCP server was on a different network. The IP address assignment by the DHCP server relies on some key concepts. The IP addresses are only assigned for a limited period of time, like being rented. The temporary assignment is called the DHCP lease. The period that the IP address is valid for is called the lease time. When the lease expires, the client shall immediately stop using that IP address and stop all communication with the IP network. Let's look at the initial client connection, or init. The client triggers the DORA, which is the discover, offer, request, acknowledge cycle to get an IP address. This pertains to two cases where the client has no IP address, and two, when the client has an invalid IP address. So the process is going to look like the following. In this example, the client boots up and the DHCP client sends a DHCP discover message indicating that it needs an IP address. This is typically a broadcast message. The DHCP server receives that message and offers a message that includes an IP address and a lease time, LT for short. The DHCP client looks at that IP address that is being offered from the DHCP server and will respond back with a request message that contains that IP address that was offered back to the DHCP server as a means of accepting the IP address. Then the DHCP server will acknowledge that this is the IP address to be used and sends the OK or an ACK message back to the client. The next scenario is the IP address usage extension. This is where the DHCP client has an IP address and would like to continue to use this IP address. At the halfway midpoint of the lease timer, sometimes referred to as T1, the client contacts the DHCP server to extend the rent of that IP address via the lease and has transitioned to a new state. This is the renewing state. The DHCP client sends a request message with its IP address as a unicast packet to the DHCP server that was provided in the IP address initially. All right, so it's not a broadcast anymore. The DHCP server will then acknowledge this by sending back an ACK message with the IP address and a new lease time. If the lease renewal fails at T1, the client will keep using the IP address until T2 or 87.5% of the lease time, and then it will try to extend the lease again. In this example, the DHCP client has received an IP address during the initial client connection. At T1, the client transitions into the renewal state and attempts to renew its IP address, but the DHCP server is not available. Therefore, it'll remain in this state until T2. At this time, the client will transition into the rebinding state and then will try to extend the lease again by repeating the request to renew the lease. However, at this time, it'll be a broadcast message so that all DHCP servers will receive the message. A DHCP server then will acknowledge this by sending an ACK message with an IP address and a new lease time. It is very important to note that if the lease time expires with no responses from the DHCP servers, the client's IP address is released and all TCP/IP communications cease, and only the transmission of the DHCP Discover broadcast messages are allowed. In other words, the DORA process starts all over again. The third scenario is a client connection after a reboot. A client holding a valid IP address contacts the DHCP server to confirm that it can keep using the IP address it was using before the reboot. In this example, it's very similar to the previous scenario. However, after the DHCP client reboots, it'll attempt to confirm its lease, even though it hasn't expired. It does this by sending a request message as a broadcast message. The DHCP server then acknowledges this request by sending the ACK message, and in the ACK message, it'll contain the IP address and the new lease time. This scenario is very likely that the client will be allowed by the DHCP server to keep using that IP address unless they have moved networks. Now, what happens if the client moves to a new network and attempts to confirm the lease that it has been assigned in the previous network? During the request to confirm the lease, the DHCP server will reject the IP address, confirming that is indicated by an invalid address by sending a NAC message to the request message. This again will start the DORA process cycle, where a new IP address will be provided with a new lease time. The last scenario is the client disconnection. A client contacts the DHCP server to release the IP address he is using. In this example, the DHCP client is terminating the lease by sending a DHCP release as a unicast message to the DHCP server that provided the IP address. The IP address will then be available in the pool of available IP addresses on the DHCP server. The termination of the leased IP address can be a manual operation from the user or an automatic operation from the client when shutting down. As previously discussed, when a DHCP client and a DHCP server are not on the same network, a relay agent is necessary. How the relay agent processes the packets is the following. During the initial discover message from the client, the relay agent will insert the DHCP server address that was configured on the router as the destination address. It will then also add its own interface address as the source address. And last, it'll insert the interface address to where the broadcast message was received from, or unicast, the same network as the client itself, into the GI adder field of the DHCP packet. This packet then will be sent to the DHCP server. The DHCP server will respond back with an offer, and now the relay agent will extract that DHCP client MAC address from the CH adder field and either send a unicast or broadcast message back to the originator's subnet, depending on the settings of the DHCP Discover broadcast bit. In the next two slides, we'll take a look at the most commonly used DHCP messages. This is kind of a summary of some of the operations that we just looked at previously. So the first one is the DHCP Discover. So this is that broadcast message that is going to be used to locate the DHCP servers that are on the network. Then we have the DHCP offer. All right, so that's the response to the DHCP discover with an offer of the configuration parameters. So this is sent by the server. Then we have a DHCP request. So sent by the client, this accepts the DHCP offer from the server or confirms the accuracy of the previously obtained parameters or to request to extend the lease. The DHCP ACT basically is sent by the server to commit the client's IP address and the configuration parameters. The DHCP NAC, the server sends that if we're rejecting the client's IP address and the configuration parameters. So that will result in a new DOR cycle. DHCP release, the client's decision to stop using the IP address that it was provided as a lease. DHCP decline, the client informs the DHCP server that the offer address that is sent is currently in use by another device on the network, so therefore the lease is canceled. DHCP inform, the client requesting the local IP address parameters in the case of an IP address of a client that has a lease and the lease is not renewed or extended. DHCP force renew. Here we have the servers notifying the client that a new configuration information is available. The client should contact the server immediately to get an IP address and or new configuration parameters. What the DHCP standard does not cover are some of the following features. The ability for the DHCP server to locate each other. The support of multiple addresses per client interfaces. The ability for the DHCP server to force the clients to release their lease. And last, a method to inform the clients that the network parameters have changed, such as a router or a domain name. The DHCP server is implemented by one organization, and there are also other vendors that are available as well. So we'll take a look at a few of them. One, the Internet Systems Consortium, or ISC. This is the original and most common implementation of DHCP. The specification was originally written by the Dynamic Host Configuration Working Group, or DHCWG, of the IETF. This is now maintained by the Internet Software Consortium, or ISC, group. DHCP server itself has a rich set of features. Microsoft Windows. So the Microsoft Windows DHCP server is embedded within the Microsoft server. It has a large customer base overall, and it does contain some features that are proprietary, such as the AD integration. Nomium DCS. This is a high-performance DHCP server, and the reason for it being high-performance is due to its limited resources and features. Cisco CRN, or Cisco Network Registrar, and we also have the Nokia VitalQuip, which is the DDI with a proprietary DHCP server. To finish, let's explore some of the DHCP RFCs that will help you understand the DHCP protocol in more depth. The most important RFCs related to DHCP are listed on this slide and the following slide. The first two RFCs are a great starting point to learn more about DHCP. RFC 2131, the Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol document, provides an overview of the protocol as well as the architecture, messages, and the parameters that are used. In RFC 2132, the DHCP Options and the BOOTP Vendor Extensions document details the configuration information that is passed from the server to the client as options.